Dr. Madhu Vaidya from Computer Science Department. Thank you, Savina ma'am, for making the wonderful beginning of the day too. This is second session on this day. Introducing our guest speaker, Dr. Nagarjun ji. He currently works in Homi Bhabha Science Center for Science Education, TIFR in Mumbai, as an associate professor. His major research interests include science education, cognitive science, history and philosophy of science, and structure and dynamics of knowledge. As an advocate of the open source environment, he focuses on free flow of information or software for today's Generation Z and serves as the chairperson of Free Software Foundation of India, that is FSF. From 2013 to 2016, Department of Computer Science has conducted a lot of sessions with him, and he is project staff on free and open source computing technologies. We too have learned a lot of things from him in this process. It is a great honor for us to have you present in today's event and enlighten us with your knowledge and wisdom. Without further ado, I request Dr. Nagarjun to take over the stage. We all will be reserving 10 minutes at the end of this session for questions and answers. Participants, please add or write your questions in the chat box so that it will be easier for us to take them up one by one. Over to you, Nagarjun sir. Thank you.
Can you hear me?
Hello? Yes, sir. We can hear you, sir.
Okay. So I'm sharing my presentation screen also.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, very good afternoon, all of you. I'm extremely sorry for technical glitch. I was forced to upgrade my old version of the software to a new version, before which it took about 5 to 10 minutes before I managed to debug the issues and managed to join today. Thank you so much. So today, since this is a gathering of various academicians working in higher education area, I thought I would talk about one of the areas that we are working. So, I've been already introduced. So this is the lab where I work. This is called the Knowledge Lab, where we design and develop collaborative STEM engagements. So though I may be using the term STEM because we work in a center for science education, but what I'm going to say is applicable to almost all the subjects that we do at higher education. So those of you who may want to visit this website for getting more understanding about what we do in the area of online education, you will be able to visit knowledge.org website. So this is what I actually planned. Let me see how it goes. I try to finish it in about 25 to 30 minutes, and then we can take some questions. So we'll first, of course, everybody knows that there is a crisis in education all over the globe, and particularly in India. And higher education space in India is not very good news, because you see, India is not in the top best institutes in the world when it comes to higher education. And so there I wanted to draw some analogy with other areas of life where we are number one and try to learn some lessons from there. And then I put together a small proposal. Maybe a part of my proposals may also appear sufficiently provocative for you, but we'll see as it goes. And then, of course, I'll end with a positive note on some kind of a pedagogical guidance on how and what we can do, which is also what the whole world is actually rethinking and reimagining how we should do education in a different way. So keeping this broad outline, so let me start with some of the perceived issues. Many of them are known to a lot of people, but I'm still saying these things to some extent so that we can actually be very clear about it. So where do we stand in the world in terms of higher education? I mean, many of us know that except in some few cases of individual success, as a whole, our standing, even in terms of the institutes or in terms of the number of people that we produce, in terms of the quality, we are certainly not in the top 100. So that is not a very good news, considering that we are such a large country with a large number of educated graduates. So something must be going wrong somewhere. So one of the diagnoses that people give is that our education system, particularly the higher education system, is only catering us to make a lot of consumers and not producers. So one way of understanding this would be, you can do a small activity. Suppose if you go to internet statistics and ask which is the topmost country which consumes most of the internet bandwidth, you would know that India is in the third place. So first place being US, second place being China, and third place being India. So that is about the consumption of the internet content. But when it comes to the production of internet content in the world, we don't have any standing in the top 100. That means we are not producing content that we want to consume. So we are mostly consuming content that is produced by others. So this is a very important diagnostic that we can understand how we place ourselves in a better place. And secondly, in our higher education system, the kind of graduates that we produce due to whatever examination systems that we do are not serving the needs of the society in general, and particularly the industry in particular. And our education depends a lot on comprehensiveness of the textbooks. We prepare lectures and we deliver courses, and we sort of try to complete the syllabus and prepare students for graduation. So this is where most of our higher education, or in general, education in general in India, is focusing a lot on. So the question then, of course, is that how do we deal with all these issues? So these are not unknown issues. Many people know many of these problems being already there. But then the question, of course, appears like, how do we actually try to resolve some of them? So is there a way out? Of course, there could be multiple responses to it. But I thought I would try to provoke you today with some way in which we have been thinking at our lab. So let us say we ask one good question, is that, is India reached excellence in any one area? Of course, there may be a couple of areas, but there is certainly one important area where India is number one. And that to me is the Indian cricket. So many of you know that India always manages to be on the top of the world in this particular game. And so is there any lesson that we can learn from this particular example? So I will try to elaborate this point with a couple of examples. So my argument will be clear very simply. So when we play games like cricket, you know, we play them together. And then, of course, we also have to ask the same question when we play our academic game in higher education institutes. Do we always play them together? How far we work in collaboration? And then when people are you know, playing games, naturally all the players get involved so actively.
Sorry, sir, to disturb you. Shall you please come closer to laptop because the sound is quite low. Is that okay?
Yeah, 1 second. So,
thank you, sir.
I can try to adjust also if possible. So, can you tell me, is it better?
Hello? Not much.
Okay. So, just give me 1 minute. I'll try to.
Yeah, sir, no problem. No
problem. I'll try to adjust the microphone. Yeah, mic test. So can you tell me, is it better?
Yes, sir, yes. Thank you.
It is better? Okay. So, I just increase the volume a little bit. Yeah. Okay. So, can you continue now?
Sir, please.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, thanks for the feedback. Yeah. So, one interesting aspect that I'm going to highlight again and again is about the need for the spectators. So, in any kind of game, like whether it is cricket, hockey or football or whatever game we play, there are a lot of spectators. And that is one of the major reasons why a lot of people, watch, and that is also a very important thing for the players as well, because people do not like to play when other people are not watching. And the other interesting thing, of course, that happens is that all the players understand the game very well, so which means that the students, teachers, I mean, if you actually try to make an analogy with what happens in our education institute, you see there is a huge gap when it comes to understanding the rules of the academic game as a whole. So here, even children who play in the street corners, they exactly know all the rules of the game, and they identify exactly when the batsman is out or exactly when the LBW is claimed and things like that. So these are, this is just an analogy to understand the gravity of the situation. And then interesting thing that happens is that suppose if there is no lab, we keep ribbing to the people saying that, okay, we don't have facilities in our college, so we can't do science or we can't do research. But look at these young people, if they don't have a playground, they will convert anything that looks like a ground into a playground. And most interestingly, anything that looks like wickets, they will use them as wickets as well. So they don't basically ask for any of these things because, it's a very innovative, involving kind of practice. And it is played in every street corner, and they don't creep about facilities. And of course, it is very inclusive. It includes all the genders. It includes all people, including children. And as you can see, the frugality is one of the interesting features that makes cricket played in every street corner. People don't look for a bat or a ball or wicket or for that matter anything. For example, in this case, this innovative person actually used package carton paper as the wicket pads. And of course, as you can see, everything that he's doing here is based entirely on imitation and innovation. So this is the kind of people that we have in the ground, and we are not made use of these innovative people in nation building. As you can see, the innovation continues. They use broomsticks or chapel, whatever comes to their access, and they use all of that as part of the game. And so the question now is that, just as we took cricket to the streets, and now what I'm actually trying to argue is that it is because that we are taking cricket to the streets that we became world class. Again, I would like to translate this sentence, and because we haven't been able to take our education to the corners and the street corner, we haven't been able to take our labs, our research onto the streets, that we haven't been able to become world class. And of course, we need to build academic clubs in every mohalla of the town. So the question then appears is that, can we use this kind of a metaphor, and can we actually do this to reimagine an alternate higher education system in the country? So I generally try to use this model. In this pyramid model, as you can see, there is a very large number of people who are at the base of the pyramid. And even if you take this as an example for cricket, you would notice that you know, the largest number of people, of course, would be everybody in the society is not playing a particular game. But out of those people, there are some people who are the spectators, which will be smaller in number than the rest of the people. And among those spectators, some of them will actually become players. And some of those players end up becoming referees or coaches. So this is like a game example that I wanted to give. And when you have this kind of a pyramid structure, we know very well from what we know from ecology, is that when the primary producers are very large in number, only then, you know, it is possible for you to gain excellence in any one area. So excellence cannot be achieved. Even if the number of people who are excellent are very few, excellence cannot be achieved unless the base of the pyramid is broad. So the current situation in higher education situation in India actually looks something like this. So there is a detachment because there are hardly any spectators for what we do in universities and colleges. Most of the people don't understand what we're doing in our colleges and universities. And so this is a major problem for various reasons. And what I am actually trying to see is that, do we have any response to trying to make these connections and make sure that we actually have spectators as well in our higher education space? So in response to this problem, we tried answering this question at Homi Bhabha Center for Science Education in some way. And we have received some encouraging results. So this is the kind of part that I wanted to say in the remaining part of the presentation. And then, of course, if we have time, we'll actually take some questions also from you. So, our objective was to actually focus a lot on projects. Of course, I will say why projects and what we should not do and what we should be doing in these cases. So we encouraged a large number of undergraduate students to create a small club with anybody who is around them, to create a club either at the end of the college or maybe inside the college, and create a small frugal lab. And in fact, the Vivekananda College is also one of the places where our hubs actually exist. People do a lot of experiments and activities even in your college. And so we have now tried to create a large number of such frugal spaces across the country. So what we normally do is we use a project as an opportunity for conversation. For us, conversation is the most important aspect of our entire intervention. And we encourage people to collaborate with each other. And as I said, this entire process is discourse driven and not delivery driven. I think this is the most important point that we need to understand, that even when we go online, we keep looking for courses that are delivered. But seldom we look for places where we can actually conduct a discourse or maybe have a conversation with other people in the profession. So this is one of the main point that we like to do. So we use frugal resources, and we try to you know, increase innovative ideas and experiments and innovations, and try to use that context for a large number of explorations. So so there is one interesting thing that happened. As I said, in the pyramid, what we were lacking was the spectators. So first of all, how can we convert our students as spectators of the higher education and academic practices in the world? And so to give that, I would like to take some examples and also discuss some of the ways in which I think we will be in a position to create a lot of spectators. Okay, so the most important thing is that, you know, the gap between the higher education and the base of the pyramid, that is the people, can only be filled when we have a community of practice. And that means that our learning environment and the colleges that we have fixed, the walls that we build have to be sufficiently porous, which essentially means that we need to actually go out and actually do projects, not only within the college, but also outside our colleges and universities. So this is what is normally, sometimes people call it as a community of practice. So this is just a caricature to show how that we need to get out of our walls of the college and universities and actually try to establish these connections with the people. And the projects that we think of doing and the challenges that we take up are actually those challenges that we want to face. At this moment, it is very important that we talk about the COVID crisis right now. Interestingly, what is happening is that this kind of interactions between higher education institutes, the governments, hospitals, as well as the community, this is exactly what we are seeing right now. The whole world is fighting against this pandemic, and this pandemic is fighting mostly by using a community of practice model. You know, everybody is trying to help in whichever way they like, and it is also for the first time that a large number of people are educated about, first of all, what is this thing called a virus. And in fact, we always had flu in India. People always suffered from cold and cough, but we never worried about them until this pandemic actually happened. So in a sense, right now we're truly visualizing a community of practice actually unfolding in our own eyes at this moment. So therefore, what is working during the pandemic time will also work in the normal time as well. On the other hand, what works in the normal time doesn't work during the pandemic time. So that is actually one of the important messages that I also want to give, is that we should always be ready as higher education institutes to face disasters and to face and work with communities of practice in so that we'll be in a position to, for example, educate our students ready for fighting any crisis of this kind. So I want to give a few examples, some very interesting stories that happened in our own examples from our own lab at Homi Bhabha Center. So this is a small example of a large number of people. In fact, some of the students also are from VES College. So this is a picture that is taken in one of the conferences that we had recently at Homi Bhabha Center. So you can see very clearly one most important feature is that there are school students as well as college students in this picture. And that is actually very important, because it is only when colleges also interact with schools that the interaction with the rest of the community actually begins to happen. So let me look at a very important thing. So while doing this activity, though we are located in Mumbai, even before the pandemic, we actually managed to reach the whole world by using online media. Like, we have used whatever communication media was possible. We used email, we used Facebook, we used WhatsApp, we used Telegram. So we also now use our own platform, which I will be talking about a little later. So we managed to reach the entire country and work with thousands of students, undergraduate students across the country in a project mode, and having been able to establish a lot of conversations and create a community of practice in which scientists, students, teachers, and sometimes often, because we are creating these labs inside the homes, even the parents, brothers, sisters, and cousins are also involved in this whole process. So this is one of the labs that has been set up during this COVID crisis, because they know that each person, each student can actually have a lab in their own home. So one of the students basically converted their study table into a lab during this COVID period. So this picture was taken sometime around the end of April, very much within the lockdown period. The people started growing model systems and actually started doing experiments at home, because we are doing exactly what we called as the FATA cricket model of the cricket being played here we are taking the FATA labs into our homes. Though the lab doesn't look very sophisticated, but then investigation happens. So in a sense, we have a small saying in our lab that sophistication is required in the mind, not in the lab. Because even without resources, it is possible for us to conduct a lot of research. So here is a story out of that kind of problem. So here, the CUBE students from across the country started collecting data about the collecting flies, and then created a graph like this. Now this graph requires the data starting from 7 a.m. in the morning to about 9 p.m. in the night. As you can see, this is actually the graph not drawn on a computer and a spreadsheet. It is drawn by the school students on a piece of paper. And it's very impressive to see that 8th and 9th standard students were actually able to create data of this kind. But what is interesting is not this data. What happened actually is that while these people were doing all this activity in 2016 and 2017, some interesting thing happened. And that is the Nobel Prize for physiology and medicine was announced. And at that time, the Nobel Prize went to sophisticated labs. Hall, Rosbach, and Eng are the three people who shared the Nobel Prize. And for doing what? They actually found out why there are two peaks in the fruit fly and why during the day they sometimes sleep and they sometimes awake. That means even if there is a banana in front of them, the fruit fly is not interested in the banana in the middle of the day. So that is how you see these two peaks. And these are the discussions that are happening by a large number of cubists across the country. And all these cubists were so jubilant when this Nobel Prize was announced. Normally, what happens when Nobel Prizes were announced, it just gets published in a newspaper and very few scientists are interested in reading. But what is it that our program managed to do is that our program managed to actually create a lot of spectators for that prize. So this is exactly what I wanted to draw an analogy with cricket and this place, is that suppose when Virat Kohli hits a century, or Dhoni or whatever, whoever is your favorite player, then we have the same kind of jubilation. And though we are not the players, but we feel as happy as the players themselves. And that is when participation becomes part of our life. So what is it that our higher education system could not manage to do is that our higher education system could not manage to create students who could become spectators of higher education research that happens across the world. Whereas even our school students in our own program, that experimental program that we did, were managing to do, of course, along with many other undergraduate students and college teachers and everybody who participated in this program. Though we managed to bring in only 100 people at our place, we have about 3,000 to 4,000 people across the country who are participating in this process. Okay, so that happened in 2017. But again, we have seen the same thing happening in 2019 Nobel Prize as well. In 2019, Nobel Prize was announced for finding out the reasons for epigenetic behavior as well as hypoxia condition in the animals. And at the same time, some interesting thing actually happened there. Let me actually show, just open this because this is very important to show. There is a website where all our students, both the our project students actually do. So here is one person called Pratik Shivaji Thorkar from Mumbai. And he is a 12th standard student at the time when he wrote this blog. So this is what happens when people actually do projects and start doing investigations. As soon as the Nobel Prize was announced, he published a blog at our website. And most interestingly, you can see, this is the last line of inspiration that I wanted to actually show. He says that someday, our cubists will surely win a Nobel Prize for his or her research in India, something that has never accomplished since independence of India until 1947. So the reason why I wanted to particularly mention this is because See, we have somehow achieved to create spectators of science and who are actually able to see what is happening in the frontiers of the research because they're themselves doing investigations. And all of you know that we hardly do any investigations in our college labs. Even in universities, we're only preparing them for passing the exams. And so this is one of the major problems that we need to solve. And when I talked about community of practice, this story is a very important story that I wanted to tell you. So this is a story about mosquito mapping. And most interesting thing actually that happened here is that the students were capturing mosquitoes. These are basically mosquitoes that are captured in their home and put it on a newspaper and then look whether these mosquitoes are actually dengue mosquitoes or anopheles mosquitoes. So one day what happened, the student, the girl student, actually went to the college. And while the student is in the college, the parents at home, particularly the mother, also started collecting the mosquitoes. And when the student came back home, the mother gave a bunch of dead mosquitoes to the student, her daughter, saying that, okay, see, look here, there is not a single dengue mosquito among them. So which means that this is what happens when projects are done at home and outside the college walls of our thing. The knowledge that we have in our books starts percolating to our mothers, parents, sisters, and things like that. So this is a student from Govandi slum who actually managed to reach out to the family because he's doing that experiment at home. So this is just an example to show that, you know, how communities of practice can be created by perforated walls of our academies. So this is a very inspiring story for us. And in fact, right now, when the pandemic actually started happening, our lab became much more active than before. And as you can see, this is not the case with most of the labs. In fact, most of the labs shut down. Whereas our labs, being already working with online education and already doing a lot of projects, so students have started doing their investigations at home. And they started creating home labs. And every evening, starting from 5 o'clock to 8 o'clock, they have an online meetings. Of course, they are using the webinar software to do that. And I mean, we call them as a chat shala. I mean, in pun of the paathshala, that in the sense that, you know, there are no lessons that are being delivered in those meetings, but all that they're doing is whatever discussions, whatever investigations they're doing at home, they're coming to these online meetings are actually discussing those problems. And actually it is at that time that all their syllabus is actually getting covered. So this is a very inspiring thing that actually happened, is that in our model, what happened was that the pandemic did not stop us from doing what we were doing. In fact, our activity increased during the pandemic time because everybody is already well connected through the social media and they're already doing collaborative work through using the social media very effectively. So this is basically a very important point that I wanted to say, is that if we do discourse-driven, collaborative, investigative projects and create an opportunity for conversation, we will be doing much more justice to our higher education than I'm going to tell you what we're actually doing otherwise. So there is another interesting point that I wanted to mention here, is that one of the important things that we do is, instead of focusing on biology, instead of focusing on engineering, instead of focusing on mathematics or various other subjects, what we focus instead is what we began to call them as STEM habits. Now these STEM habits are, they cut across all disciplines, that anyone from anywhere across the disciplines will find many of these STEM habits that have been listed here are useful. For example, almost every subject needs some mathematical skills. And particularly, as you know, that the current crisis of COVID tells us how important is the data and how important is statistical thinking and how important are the plots. In fact, for the first time, a lot of people understood there is something called flattening the curve. And this is a mathematical modeling exercise that people are doing. And now a large number of people have got excited and understood about exactly what is the meaning of that. So it is important to develop this kind of mathematical imagination than just merely covering some topic of a particular subject. Similarly, for engineering habits, tinkering, parametric thinking, calibration, etc. Similarly, for design thinking, and quickly going through these things, please look at the website, and also I'm going to share the slides to all of you as we go by. So as you can see, for example, the current crisis is completely being managed with a lot of data, in fact a lot of big data and a lot of observation that is coming all over the place, and without which no science can actually be done, whether it is social science, geography, or epidemiology, or biology, or physics, chemistry, whatever the subject that you do. All these are important things. So unfortunately, our syllabus doesn't talk about them as the focus area. This is only covered as a part of many of the other things. Therefore, these are sidelined, including, of course, the thinking and reasoning activities as well. And last and most important is the communication habits as well. That is the reporting, note-taking, citation, presenting, narrating, and things like that. So these are also some of the things that we completely neglect in our higher education system. And so we have a lot to learn from many of these things, which the West is very good in doing. First of all, in school education itself, all the children, all the students in the West learn how to, for example, write a journal every day and start sharing those journals and write letters to people and things like that. Anyway, so whether you call them as STEM habits or you want to call them as academic habits, so it is important that let us focus our higher education and keep these STEM habits as the syllabus and not the topics of our own subjects. So the topics only become a context, but if the goal is basically to develop the STEM habits, then we will have enormous amount of time to cover our syllabus. So, and of course, the question always arises that when you are actually doing these projects, what are we going to do about assessment? So what we do regarding the assessment is, when people are doing this in our online portal, we give them badges of this kind, for example. So if somebody is very inquisitive, so we give him inquisitive badge. Somebody is a statistical thinker because he demonstrated statistical thinking in his writing. Somebody has done some calibration of the instrument, so he gets a calibrator badge, etc. So for experimental design, as well as for designing, as well, even for art and data visualization, so we give badges to all the people. So towards the end, I would like to say a few things to provoke all of you in higher education. I think the time has come to reimagine our higher education. So I'm basically saying some extreme things, so you may not like it, but still take it from me today. So stop giving lectures in the schools and colleges and universities. Don't give courses. Instead, please design investigation and innovative projects and ask students to do those projects, and then look up on the internet, look up in the textbooks, look up in the libraries to find out how the context, the project context, actually helps them to bring in the content and the topics that are included in our curriculum. And so take away the classrooms and convert them into chat shalas. And this is in fact one of the important outcomes of various people who have been talking about educationists all over the world are talking about it. They're saying that, let us focus on blended learning. Don't use the school and college time for lessons, delivering lessons, but use them for discussion. Use them for question answer session and things like that. And also convert your labs into project studios. And of course, very important is that, we keep recommending very comprehensive and very good textbooks. And one problem with the comprehensive textbooks is that, because everything is there and contained in the whole process, it basically makes people completely questionless. Because for every question, there is some answer in the book. And therefore, not many questions are asked, because there are very few openings in the comprehensiveness, because that is the meaning of being comprehensive. And we try to do that whenever we write textbook. We try to close all the holes so that no gap is left out and nothing is unsaid. And so this is one of the problems that we have. As I already mentioned, instead of completing the syllabus, try to make STEM habits or academic habits as our syllabus. And of course, the last point is a little more provocative. All that I wanted to say is that, you know, don't try to put all the people who are at the same cognitive level in one class. Instead, you know, try to bring seniors and juniors into one single project. Then a lot of discussion happens. In fact, the school students, when they're mixed with the college students, you would not imagine that the school students challenge the college students so much that the college students actually have to look up all over the world to find out answers to those questions that the inquisitive school students keep asking. So this is basically a model by which, you know, if you create a lot of potential difference in the classrooms, there is a possibility for a lot of conversation that happens in the schools. And then, so I wanted to add a few more provocative statements. So don't prepare the students to sit and succeed in the exam. We have done enough of this damage already, and this is not going to help them to join a professional life. And then again, do not assess students for only the content, but please start assessing their process skills, which is what I'm calling it as STEM habits. And again, you know, there's a lot of hype about online platforms, and there is a lot of hype about learning management systems, whether free or proprietary, whatever they come. But then my main point is that these online learning management systems are also becoming delivery platforms. And that is my main complaint. So don't use these delivery platforms, use them for discussion. So do not use online webinars for delivery of content, but use that as a blended environment to discuss, answer questions, just as our chat shalas are actually doing during the COVID period, you know, every day from 5 o'clock till 8 o'clock in the night. So it is in that sense that, you know, use these online academies. And I will be just mentioning to you, though I will not be having enough time to discuss in detail about the platform. So I will not discuss these pedagogical principles. So these are important principles that we have obtained through our experience for the last 19 years of experiment in this area. So I will share this the slides to all the participants, and I will ask the organizers to share it also on their website, so that you'll be able to ask maybe more questions to you. And so this is what we actually dub it as, you know, COOL with three O's: collaborative, open, online, ongoing learning, in a participatory way to expand the participatory base of academic education or higher education in the country. So for that, I'm inviting all of you to, you know, this site. I won't be able to do any demonstration of this site in today's short meeting, but please do visit metastudio.org. All of you are invited. Please invite your students also. This is one place where students, teachers from across the country are participating and discussing and on all kinds of topics that deal with both higher education as well as some part of the school education as well. So thank you, and I am ready to take questions.
Thank you so much, sir, for sharing various wonderful and innovative ideas like academic clubs, charshala based on parshala, home labs, and many more carried out at Homi Bhabha Science Center. It was really cool to know about COOL concepts. It was enriching and great experience, learning experience, to understand your thoughts on practical learning mechanisms using open source. So, sir, we would start with the question and answers now. Without, I will not take much time. The first question is from Prajakta Megaukar and Rajendra More. Sir, how can we make students focus on higher education if their financial background is very weak, or their parents are not educated, or they don't have access to the softwares?
Well, essentially, this is always a big question. So we try to do in various ways. First of all, making many of these things accessible to people requires, you know, the college labs being accessible to students who do not have access to such gadgets at home. And since the software that we use in free and open source does not cost anything, so it is possible to take this software to all the people. And in those areas where there is no internet, even in such places we have developed some innovative ways in which, you know, we can create local area networks in remote colleges and remote schools. So there is a possibility of responding to those things, but it's a huge challenge. I completely agree with the questioners. So this is the place where the administration, the college administration, as well as the governments, etc., have to come together to resolve these problems.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Later question is question about the cricket analogy which you described.
Yeah.
Who exactly are the spectators that are being referred to in education? That is from Dr. Jyoti Tope.
Yeah. So essentially, what I'm saying is something like this. Suppose we have educated a large number of graduates. In fact, India is one of the largest higher education graduates produced anywhere in the world. However, if you actually look at the issue, very few of those people know anything that is happening by the champions in science. So a champion in cricket is always admired. So what about those people who are the top of the world in science? So that means, essentially, my point is that as teachers, we fail to convert our students into spectators of science or spectators of academic projects. So a lot of news comes out in various places, a lot of journals report a lot of achievements. So the students really don't want to go and look at that place because we never told them, or we haven't even exposed them to those rules of the game. You know, for example, even now we struggle a lot, even as teachers, we struggle a lot to write a research paper because we don't know, we don't understand the rules of the game. We get very desperate and dejected when our papers get rejected from top journals. Why? Because we haven't understood the rules of the game. Like, we don't cite very well, we are not up to the mark in terms of trying to find out the updates. So that is what I meant as the students. So if we actually expose our students to investigation projects in our schools and colleges, instead of telling them about content and lessons all the time, then what happens is that, every investigation project requires them to go and read something from journals. And in the process, what happens is they get to expose to them. And in fact, what we have seen is that many of our students often write letters to those scientists because they have some questions, and in the process they have already established a community of practice, and in the process when a prize is announced or some interesting innovation happens, some science news comes out, they're able to relate to that story, to their life. And so this is what I mean by saying that the current education system in India has failed to create spectators. I'm not even talking that, we are not players of the science. We're actually saying that forget about being players, we haven't even created spectators. So at least we should create spectators. It's a very good indicator that, that we have managed to reach a large mass. So I'm saying that the if higher education institutes try to create that kind of spectators, that will be very good. So we conduct one interesting competition every year. And this is a very interesting example to answer your question. So this competition is, we ask the undergraduate students as well as the graduate students, whoever is there, to predict in September who is going to get the Nobel Prize in October. As you know, every October, Nobel Prizes are announced. So whatever be their subject, the subject could be economics, the subject could be physics, whatever it is, you know, if they actually can predict the Nobel Prize, which means that they have to understand what are the best discoveries that happened in the last 10 to 15 years in each of their subjects. If they know that, you know, they make connections with their practice. So this is how you make spectators.
Correct, sir. Thank you. Later question is, what are your suggestions for science practical at UG PG level? How to manage during this crisis? Videos on YouTube may not be able in line with university syllabus. That is from Karun Soda and Rekha Bhatia.
Yeah, so what I would suggest is, you know, these are the questions that are frequently asked, and we managed to solve some of these problems ourselves by, for example, creating frugal labs at their home. And people are actually conducting experiments sitting at home and, then, you know, taking photographs and recording videos and then sharing them online with everybody else. So this they were doing earlier also, and they continue to do now even more during this pandemic. So I actually wanted to say this following thing. It's very unfortunate. I lost some time in the beginning, so I actually lost out. I'm getting calls because the other meeting is already started. So may I request all of you to please, use my email and send me more questions. So I will be in a position to reply to all of them.
Sure.
I'm very sorry to cut this conversation. I'm sure there are many questions. And please send me those questions, then I will also be able to answer them through email.
Sure, sir. Thank you very much. No problem. We will share your mail ID with the participants, and they can get the direct answer from you. Sir, I would like to just say a few words. It was indeed a pleasure for us to hear your thoughts and patiently answering the questions. We came to know today about the Making the STEM Habits for Developing Technologies, and open source initiatives which can be used for students to make them more competitive. The idea of keeping one senior over juniors can also be implemented. Yes, really, we can implement it at college level. Finally, we would like to conclude this session because sir has got other meetings. By saying pandemic would not stop us from implementing innovative ideas. Thank you very much, sir. It was really a pleasure for us hearing you.
Thank you so much for sharing my ideas. And I'm again, apologies for cutting the question answer session.
No, sir, sure, it's okay. That is not a problem at all.